RadioOrNot.com and SoFloRadio.com present The Nicole Sandler Show.
Truth to power, baby.
And now, here's Nicole.
Welcome to a Thursday. Nicole Sandler here with you live at RadioOrNot.com, SoFloRadio.com, TalkRadio1.com, or perhaps via the magic of time warping. Yeah, the podcast. Anytime, anywhere, always free at RadioOrNot.com. I let the pre-show music go a little long this morning just to keep within the theme of last night. Did you watch the 12-12-12 concert? Yeah, there were, you know... It's the 2010s, right? It's the second decade of the 21st century, right? Just checking, because wow, a lot of old white guys last night. You know, a lot of old British white guys too. Where were the women? I know Alicia Keys was there. Okay, and I guess she filled two categories: woman, person of color, right? I missed Kanye West, and apparently that was a good thing. I hear he was wearing a leather skirt. Okay. Right. Well, from Chicago said, I watched some, but where was Bonnie Raitt? Really? I mean, you know, Alicia Keys, I thought, was excellent. She's a very talented woman. She's from New York. She lives, but really? I mean, no women? And here's my thinking why they went for the over 60 rock and roll crowd, is because they figure, look, the whole purpose of this event was to raise money. So they went for the demographic that has money. And I guess that's, you know, old white people, right? It's the best I could figure. Yeah, why not Sheryl Crow? I could do without Sheryl Crow. Nora Jones, well, she probably wasn't asked, but she's, you know, her father just died. Her father is Ravi Shankar. I don't know if they ever reunited. They didn't have a good relationship, but Ravi Shankar died yesterday. But yeah, I mean, really, they couldn't have found a woman who, like, would have worked there? Even like Mary J. Blige or somebody. I guess they couldn't have two black women. That would be too much. And I wish I could have pulled this sound clip, because my favorite clip of the night came from Mick Jagger, who looked at the camera sort of incredulously and said, this is a reunion. This is old white British guys. Well, he said it with a British accent, not a Southern accent. And then he said, so if it rains in London, you all have to come and help us out, too. Yeah. Right. I got to pull that clip because, you know, really. And rather than if it rains, it should be when it rains, because this Sandy disaster is just the first of, well, not even the first. I think it's the wave of the future. We better start learning to live with these major weather disasters, because this is what climate change does. Yes. Yes, it does. No, Bob Dylan wasn't there last night. Bob Dylan should have been there. You know, another old white guy. Anyway, for the pre-show music, I did play Eddie Vedder singing with Roger Waters on "Comfortably Numb." Definitely one of the highlights. I thought the Roger Waters set was excellent, especially since I went to see The Wall a year or so ago. And although it was great, it was only... only The Wall. He didn't do anything else. I thought on an encore, maybe they'd come out and do some Dark Side stuff. They didn't then, but they did last night. And for the David Gilmour parts, I don't know who the other guy was who was singing. And I'm thinking, because I'd heard all along that Eddie Vedder was going to be with Roger Waters. And it's like, it doesn't really look like Eddie Vedder, but I guess it could be him if he's gotten like uglier. And his nose grew a little bit. But the voice, I mean, it was a pleasant enough voice, but didn't sound like Eddie Vedder. And sure enough, when Eddie Vedder came out, then it's like, oh, okay, that's Eddie Vedder. And he sounded great. I mean, I thought Comfortably Numb was excellent. So hopefully you tuned in a little early. You got the Comfortably Numb. I also played the duet in the pre-show music between Michael Stipe and Chris Martin on Losing My Religion. It's funny. My David is, you know, sort of an old fart. And so at the beginning of the show, when they're running down the name, the names of the performers, Bruce Springsteen, John Bon Jovi, The Rolling Stones, The Who, Chris Martin. David says, who? Like, Chris Martin. Coldplay. It's like, why is he here? But Coldplay. Coldplay is, you know, they have been elevated to superstar status in the last decade. And, you know, fits in there, although it should have been Coldplay. Chris Martin, nobody knows who Chris Martin is. I think this was a big Robert Hill in New York City is asking, David is sort of what? Old fart. So 4 of 9 says Bon Jovi sucks. Yeah, I gotta say, look, the show opened with Bruce. You know me. I'm a big Bruce fan. Huge Bruce fan. I'm pissed off at Bruce because this Wrecking Ball tour, first of all, Wrecking Ball, the album, is awesome. And they didn't come down here. The beginning of the tour, the beginning of the first leg of the tour, Springsteen played in Tampa. Well, Tampa is at best a 4-hour drive from where I am in South Florida. Tampa is not South Florida, even though the University of South Florida is in Tampa. Tampa is not South Florida. And on the last couple of tours, Bruce did come down here to the Miami-Fort Lauderdale area. When I say South Florida, I mean Southeast Florida. And, you know, although he did it on the second leg of the tour, so I figured, all right, there's no South Florida date on the first leg. He'll come down on the second leg. Well, he does the first leg, then they go to Europe, right, do the European tour, and then they come back for the second leg. Still no South Florida date announced. And then they start, you know, they're adding dates. And so I keep checking and nothing. And now they've started adding, you know, announcing dates for the second European leg. And still nothing down here. Bruce, what the fuck? So, you know, I have to see him on these. I have to see him play on the TV for Obama and see the, you know, a 30-minute set. Not enough. I'm really upset about this. Anyway. So I get my 30 minutes of Bruce. And then, you know, as he's going to into Born to Run, he brings out John Bon Jovi. We have a joke here. John Bon Jovi does a commercial for, I don't know what it is. I don't know what the commercial is for. But he's like, I'm John Bon Jovi. Singer, songwriter, philanthropist, father. Really? Singer, songwriter, philanthropist, father? Father comes after philanthropist? After singer-songwriter? No wonder his daughter OD'd on heroin. Just saying. I mean, I'm sorry. No, maybe that was a low blow. I'm not a Bon Jovi fan. Can you tell? So the fact that Bruce had to bring out Bon Jovi? Seriously? You know, it sort of ruined it for me. But I didn't let it ruin it too much. And then, so after Bruce played, who was second? Was it the Rolling Stones? I'm trying to remember. I think it was the Rolling Stones. And then, and then Adam Sandler in there. And then Bon Jovi came on. And that's when I went in. I took a shower. So I showered during Bon Jovi. I don't remember the exact, order of the lineup. I thought Adam Sandler, my brother, did us well. You know, my brother, Adam, got the comedy genes in the family. And I missed the Bon Jovi set. And then David, as I came out of the shower, he goes, yeah, Bruce joined Bon Jovi. It's like, I don't care. Look, it's not, you know, it's, yeah, I'm a fan of Bruce, but I want to see him do the Springsteen music. I really don't need to hear him join Bon Jovi on a Bon Jovi song. It does nothing for me. Not seriously. Come on. So, and then The Who, the band I refer to as The Two. Because they are the two. The Who was Roger Daltrey, Pete Townsend, Keith Moon, and John Entwistle. Okay. After Keith Moon died, I'm sorry, the Who was kind of over. But they kept touring anyway, and I guess they got Jason Bonham to fill in once, right? Is that, and maybe, oh, Zach Starkey. In fact, I saw The Who after Keith Moon died, and Zach Starkey filled in for Keith Moon. And he was pretty awesome. Zach Starkey, Ringo Starr's son. Good stuff. But after John Entwistle died, you know, I'm sorry. It's The Two. It's not The Who, it's The Two. And Roger Daltrey, even on his best day, had trouble hitting those notes. You know what I'm saying? And then last night, you know, I'm sorry, these guys are all pushing 70. Really. I'm sorry. They're pushing 70. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but Roger Daltrey, we don't need you to unbutton your shirt when you're pushing 70. Just keep it buttoned up. Just sing. And the dancing, I'm sorry, he looked like, you know, an old white guy, you know, with old white guy rhythm. Yeah. And people on Facebook today, I'm looking at the comments, and some of them are saying, well, The Who sounded great. No, The Two sounded like The Two. And yeah, Pete Townsend can play guitar, but enough. Really, I mean, enough. And Mick Jagger. First of all, Mick Jagger needs to eat a cheeseburger. Seriously, the guy is too skinny. His fit, he looks like Skeletor. And a friend of mine, Steve McPartlin, or a sort of a right-winger on Facebook, said, I give all these people, all these performers credit for going out there and performing and giving their time and energy and everything. But I was literally rolling on the floor laughing at Mick Jagger prancing around the stage. I mean, the guy will be 70 this summer. Really. And after watching that documentary, Crossfire Hurricane, with Mick as a young lad, really, Mick, I don't know. I guess you want to cash in one last time, but wow. Wow. Anyway, we'll play one more highlight of it. I was looking forward to seeing what song Adam Sandler was going to do. I didn't think he would do the Hanukkah song, even though it is Hanukkah. But he did a new, a unique version of Hallelujah, the Leonard Cohen song, in honor of, giving a big middle finger to Sandy. So we will share that later on in the show. All right. Okay. But before we get to that, it is Thursday. Maysoon Zayid will join us, and our buddy Boca Brittany will join in too, because she's such a big fan of Maysoon's. So we'll put them together. But I want to start with a story that I just briefly touched on yesterday when we were going through the story about Michigan union busting. And at the protest outside, you know, I was watching Tweety yesterday. And Chris Matthews showed the video that Fox has been running in high rotation of a supposed union thug punching out this Fox guy. Now, I don't watch Fox, so I don't know the guy, Steven Crowder, who apparently is a comedian Fox News contributor. Uh-oh. Did I dial the phone number wrong? I probably did. It is... Okay, I see what I did. It's 734. Okay, hold on. Well, we're calling Chris Savage. Chris Savage, you might know him on Twitter as Eclectablog, and he also runs Eclectablog.com. And Eclectablog, I got to be honest with you, I didn't...
Good morning.
Hey, Chris, it's Nicole Sandler calling from Radio or Not. How are you doing this morning?
I'm doing great, Nicole. How are you?
I'm doing fine. Thanks so much for jumping on with us this morning on such short notice. Now, Chris Savage is people can follow you on Twitter at Eclectablog, and you blog at Eclectablog.com, along with, honestly, one of my favorite tweeters, LOLGOP, is one of your contributors.
Yeah, one of the smartest guys around right there.
Very funny. I didn't know of your site until yesterday when I saw your expose on this this Breitbart style, or I should say O'Keefe style video that Fox has been running ad nauseum about one of those union thugs punching out this Fox News contributor. I guess he's a comedian, Steven Crowder. Now you got to bear with me because I don't often watch Fox. I just have a it's sort of like the, I don't know, like an effect out of Harry Potter. When my TV goes near Fox, it throws back from the television set. So I can't physically do it. But I saw Chris Matthews. It really sort of scolding those union people. We need an answer. Why is this kind of stuff happening? Well, that kind of stuff didn't really happen.
There were some people there that were doing some stuff that they shouldn't have been doing, definitely. But when you've got a crowd of 18 to 20,000 people, you're going to get some folks that are doing some dumb stuff. I mean, that's it's the classic case of painting the whole swath of tens of thousands of people based on the actions of a handful of them, and it's just absolutely ridiculous.
Okay, but what happened, as it seems, and you've delineated in this post that I will link to on my blog after the show today, that basically Crowder goes on Fox with this video, and it looks pretty incendiary. It looks like, you know, they were the innocent victims of these, and I'll use their words in air quotes, union thugs, who not only tore down the tent that was up there, the Americans for Prosperity tent, you know, the Koch brothers, teabaggers tent, and then punched this guy in the face. But what the video, the unedited videos that you also have up there seem to be showing is, number one, they set up this tent to come down. By they, I mean the Americans for Prosperity people, and sort of set it up to look like it was the union protesters who did that, who brought the video down. That's the first part. Do I have that right?
At least one of them. There were actually two tents, and at least one of them, there was an eyewitness that watched one of the FP guys go around and loosen all the straps on it before it came down. So that looked like it was a fairly intentional act on their part.
And then this guy, Stephen Crowder, it's the video that we're seeing ad nauseum was him being punched by a union guy. And tell us what happened there, because I'm not quite sure I have the facts straight here.
It's probably useful to have a little bit of background on this. This rally was planned last Thursday, Friday, after the governor of Michigan, Rick Snyder, announced that he would be supporting right-to-work legislation when it came to his desk. And when the union folks went to reserve the front of the Capitol, which you can do, they found that conservative groups had basically reserved the Capitol steps all 3 days of the session. The day of the rally was actually reserved by a group called, it's not coming to my mind right now, but Involve America. And Involve America came up in September 2011. It was supposed to, September 2011, they were supposed to be a students, you know, concerned about their future type of group. They did exactly three campus events, and then were never heard from again until they reserved the steps of the Capitol on Tuesday. Americans for Prosperity set up two gigantic tents on the lawn. Throughout the day, there was very few people in those tents, despite what you may be hearing, from your conservative friends online. Those tents were basically empty all day. They would not let union folks in there, and they were just basically there handing out literature that was sort of designed to, you know, piss off the union folks that were there. There were two tents. One of them came down, like I said, after the straps had been loosened. Crowder had spent the day going around basically getting in people's faces, crowding their personal space, freaking them out, and then asking them, you know, questions designed to really get them upset. And this was a group of people who are, you know, they're looking at their livelihoods going away or at least being diminished by this right-to-work legislation.
Right.
So they were pretty upset. What you see in the short minute and a half or so video that you're seeing ad nauseum on Fox News is, you know, it looks like Crowder's, you know, just sort of out of the blue attacked by this guy. But if you look at the footage that Hannity put up, which shows an extra few seconds ahead of time, you see that the guy that goes after him is actually having to get up off the ground because he'd already been knocked down.
Huh.
And he was just responding to being attacked himself. We don't know, you know, what caused that, if it was actually Crowder that knocked him down or somebody else. But when he got up, he went after Crowder, and he did take a swing at him, no question about it. You know, I'm not a person to condone violence or any type of mayhem, but these guys were out there sticking their thumb in the eyes of these union people and waiting for this to happen. And it wasn't just Crowder that was there. Lee Stranahan from Breitbart.com was there.
Right.
You know, this was a setup, and they were just out there to incite, attacks against themselves, I guess you could put it, and then get it all on tape. And as soon as that happened, they shut things down, went back and started editing tape and getting it up online as quickly as possible.
Wow.
And Crowder spent the rest of the day, you know, tweeting it out to everybody.
Of course. So because that furthers their whole meme that it's their union thugs. See, this is what they do.
Yeah. Mm. That's exactly right. And it's, you know, and it's just what I'm calling it is, you know, tent gate, because they're trying to create a distraction against the real conversation that we should be having, which is that the birthplace of organized labor in this country, Michigan, is now a right-to-work state where unions have been, you know, basically kneecapped by groups funded by the Koch brothers and Dick DeVos and Mackinac Center for Public Policy and all these really super conservative anti-labor groups that have been basically laying in wait for, you know, literally years waiting for their moment in the sunshine when they had control of both houses of the legislature and the governor's office. So their plan is working out perfectly, and it's being abetted by these, you know, far-right conservative news, and I use that term very loosely, organizations that are out to, you know, change the narrative to make it look like it was this crowd of 18,000 violent union members, which it clearly was not.
No.
You know, and one of our former state reps, Mark Schauer, was involved. He's part of the Blue-Green Alliance. He's a very big friend of labor, and, you know, he was actually pepper sprayed unprovoked by the state police. So there was, you know, if you look at the pictures that came out of that thing, the state police had this monstrous presence there. So it just makes you wonder why Crowder didn't actually file any charges or anything. He never went and got a cop to, you know, settle things down. He was just out there sort of stirring things up and waiting for somebody to take a swing at him. But, you know, the big point is that they put together this tape that was completely, you know, it tells a totally different story. And it's composed of video from various parts of the day. The tape starts out with him interviewing some guys and then goes immediately to the mayhem. And it looks like they just turned on him during the middle of this conversation. But the conversation happened early in the morning, and the part that they cut to didn't happen until hours later. So they put this thing whole together to create a narrative that didn't actually occur.
Boy, Andrew Breitbart might be dead, but his practices live on, huh?
Yeah, in some ways, these guys that are wannabes are even worse than he was.
Yeah, that's no kidding. So Chris
O'Keefe spent the day tweeting it as well.
Of course he did. What a little twerp. I'm amazed that he's still walking the street. Chris Savage is with us. So you write, you blog at Eclecta Blog, and you are based in Michigan. So let me ask you, as a Michigan progressive blogger, your thoughts on what happens next? Where do we go now? Or where do you go now?
That's the big question. I think our attention needs to turn to the 2014 midterms. You know, the 2010 midterm is really clobberous in Michigan as well as other states across the country. You know, we took a state that was blue, and it turned fairly red thanks to a lot of Tea Party anger over the Obama administration and other things. And by losing the House and the Senate and the governor's office, that allowed them to do a lot of the stuff that they're doing now. And they redistricted it to make it much more difficult now for us to elect Democrats. But we have to overcome that, because if we don't get at least one house of the legislature back, you know, we're going to be struggling with this for a long time. So, I'm already seeing organization happening from the unions and other progressive groups to start to get people focused on the midterm election so that we don't have to pay this price again. But, you know, we elected Barack Obama by a 10% margin in November, and Democrats got over half the vote in all the state races. Yet, because of the gerrymandering, we still barely picked up a handful of seats. So we've got a lot of work to do. We've got a lot of ground to make up.
Now the you know, they jammed this anti-union bill, the right to, I hate using the term right to work. I live in Florida, a so-called right to work for less state, a right to be fired at will state, a right to be treated like shit state. Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly. So I hate using their terminology, but they jammed this through in the lame duck state session because obviously the new legislature comes in January. Now, what is the makeup of that? Is obviously more
We picked up, I think, five seats, and if you look at the votes on this right-to-work legislation, they wouldn't have passed it because it only passed by about a five-vote margin. So that's why they have to do this stuff now. And this right-to-work stuff is only part of it. They're putting they passed legislation out of the House and Senate yesterday to do things like make it legal to carry a gun in a school, for example, a concealed weapon.
There's
two different bills that impact women's reproductive health access in terms of, you know, making it very difficult for clinics that are providing abortion services to stay in business, and allowing doctors and other healthcare providers to use their conscience to decide not to treat people. And then they've also, we just got done repealing Public Act 4, which was the Emergency Manager Act, and they now have passed out of the House more legislation to replace that. And this time, like they did with the right to work legislation, they put an appropriation in it, which means that they can't put it on the ballot as a citizens referendum this time around. So, you know, but they're not done yet. They've still got 4 days left in this session, and there's much more to be done.
Oh my God! And I hear there's some real bad, really anti-woman legislation up there too.
Yeah, Michigan's going to become one of the most regressive states in terms of women's access to reproductive services in Michigan. One of the bills that's coming up right now puts such onerous and absurd restrictions and requirements on clinics that provide abortions that it's going to be very, very difficult for most of these clinics to stay open. You know, it's interesting to know that in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, I believe there are no clinics that provide abortions, that women that live up there that want to have an abortion have to travel out of state or downstate to get that kind of service. So, you know, we're staring down the barrel of a very conservative gun right now, and it's being funded by people like Dick DeVos, who's just got millions and millions of dollars. He pumped tons of money into a proposal that was on the ballot in November to enshrine collective bargaining rights in our state constitution, and now he's getting his payback with this right to work legislation that's being passed. Like I said, they've been waiting for a long time to execute this plan, and they were ready to do it. And in 2 short years, they've completely run the state over.
It really did take everyone by surprise, didn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I think the speed with which they did it took people by surprise. The fact that they wanted to do it didn't. I mean, the right to work stuff, they've been discussing that for years, and the Mackinac Center has been pimping this stuff for almost a decade now, and putting money into it and just, putting out, information to people to try to sway public opinion and stuff. Lee Fang did a really good job of looking at the amount of money that's being spent on the right to work drive, and, the Mackinac Center and Americans for Prosperity have just pumped tons of money, and they've dramatically outspent progressive groups that have been trying to fight it. Americans for Prosperity was running television ads in the week leading up to that vote. Television ads that don't really, because all people can do is call their legislators, but they're just out there making sure that people are doing that. So they're effective. We've got some stuff to learn. When we get the power back, we need to be ready to execute our plan too, because we don't have time to waste. When you get power, you have to use it right away, and they've shown how effective they can be at doing that.
I hear you. Chris Savage, Eclectablog on Twitter, and eclectablog.com for all the latest.
And Facebook, yep.
Mm-hmm. And Facebook. Okay, well, I'll put links on my blog at radioornot.com. It's so nice to meet you. I thank you for your work and for coming on this morning, and I hope we can talk again.
All right, Nicole, thanks a lot.
All right, take care. Yeah, it sounds like there's going to be a lot more news coming out of Michigan in the days and weeks and months and years to come. All right. We got stuff to do. And Howie Klein, Down with Tyranny, will join us in a few minutes as well. So let's take a very quick break, and we'll come back and talk to Howie next. Don't go away. Nicole Sandler, Radio or Not.
Why does John Boehner keep pushing bogus budget?
Wrong one.
The commanding general of the Tea Party Army has gotten the boot. Hear what else he got today on Hightower Radio. Lightning's flashing, winds are howling, and there's a tempest in the Tea Party. Why, it's Dick Armey, the blowhard, former Republican majority leader, corporate lobbyist, Koch brothers retainer, and commanding general of the Tea Party Army. Dick's always been stormy. In 2002, he had an unpleasant split with his fellow legislative hucksters Newt Gingrich and Tom DeLay. So he spun through Congress's revolving door right into the K Street lobbying hustle. In 2004, he became a honcho of a Koch-funded corporate front group with the spiffy name of Freedom Works, an outfit that works by hook and crook to free corporations from pollution rules, unions, taxes, and other bothers. Then, in 2009, when angry Tea Partiers exploded onto the scene, Army immediately rushed out to co-opt them, diverting their leaders away from the group's initial fury at Wall Street into a mob frenzy over Obamacare and big government. This corporate frontman and lifelong Washington insider essentially conscripted the helter-skelter bunch of outsiders into the Republican Party by providing Koch money, Freedom Works political operatives, and even writing their Tea Party manifesto. Slick! But now, Dick's dander is up again, and he's splitting from Freedom Works. He resigned with a testy email prohibiting the organization, quote, from using my name, image, or signature in any way. Like other ugly divorces, this one had its petty oddities. For example, Army's email insisted that Freedom Works must, quote, deliver the copy of my official congressional portrait to my home. This is Jim Hightower saying, in case you're worried about what'll happen next to poor Dick, don't. To move Army out as general of today's badly depleted Tea Party Army, Freedom Works will pay him $400,000 a year for the next 20 years. Slick!
Need an antidote to the progressive blues? Want some good news about how grassroots folks are rebelling against the corporate powers and winning? Well, here's an easy-to-swallow pill for you, the Hightower Lowdown. Hightower's monthly newsletter will give you the lowdown, even as it lifts you up. It's 4 pages a month, jam-packed with facts you can use, actions you can take, and Jim's own Texas humor, all for only $15 a year. To become a lowdowner, go to HightowerLowdown.org.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
All right. Yes, it is Radio or not.com. Let's get Howie Klein on the line, shall we? Howie, of course, blogs at downwithtyranny.com. You can follow him on Twitter at downwithtyranny.
Morning, Nicole.
Good morning, Howie. How are you?
I'm pretty good. How about you?
I'm doing well, thank you. Before we get into politics, I got to ask you, because we both come out of the music world. You, of course, were the president of Reprise Records for so many years. That your background before you... you got very political, was in the music industry. Did you watch any of the big concert last night?
I didn't.
You didn't? All right.
Didn't watch it. I was, I'm getting ready for a trip to India.
Mm.
So it's like all my time is pretty much scripted out between now and when I leave.
Gotcha. Oh, so India, just you're such a world traveler. I always love your the stories of your travels. This is just a vacation?
Yeah, just a vacation.
Cool. Nice. So you're going to be in India for New Year's or for the end of the world on the 21st?
Hey, both. I'm going to Delhi, which is a place I've been going to since 1970, and I like very much. And then we're going down to Kerala, which is, kind of remote place on the southwest coast of India and kind of ruralish and real beautiful. And we rented a house there.
Wow.
And I'm going to stay there about a month.
Nice. Oh, then I'm glad I got you today. You know, I had been thinking, I emailed you early this morning, said, it's been a while, there's stuff going on, can you talk? And then you said you're going to be gone starting next week. So, good. Well, I'm glad I had you on today. So, then let me ask you about what is going on in D.C. I mean, I almost made a pledge, like, never to say the words fiscal cliff again. First of all, because I hate that framing.
Well, I love
you, number
you're one. A fiscal bluff. That's a better phrase.
Fiscal bluff, or as my friend Anat Shankar says, fiscal crossroads, because that's really what it is. It's when they decide which way do we go. Do we go on the road to austerity, or do we go on the road to, you know, taking care of the people who need help? What do we do? This is a crossroads. It's not a cliff. We don't fall off it. Whatever. The bottom line is, though, you know, there's posturing on both sides. The thing that scares the shit out of me is the talk that we're hearing that they may raise the Medicare eligibility age.
Well, they may. I mean, the Republicans certainly want to.
Of course they do.
If they get their chance, they will. It looks like, so now it's a matter of numbers. Look, there are two ways to look at this thing.
Mm-hmm.
How many Republicans can Boehner bring to the party with him to pass the compromise that he and so-called compromise that he and Obama have worked out? So they've got, and no one knows what it is. I mean, I'm sure some people know what it is, but I don't know what it is. I don't think any bloggers know what it is. We all suppose we know some things, but we don't really know. We can guess. That's all. But so Obama and Boehner have this thing worked out, more or less. They have the contours worked out. So how many Democrats in the House are needed to pass it? That's the big question. Because the more Democrats that Boehner needs, the better it's going to be for progressives.
Right.
Because they won't go certain places. If all Boehner needs is just a bunch of blue dogs and the new Dems, if that's all he needs, there's no problem. They can pass anything they want. Will they pass an increase in the age of eligibility? You bet they will, because the new Dems and the blue dogs don't care about that. On the other hand, if there are enough Republicans desert him, which looks like it's happening, then he's going to need some real Democrats. And if he needs real Democrats, they're not going to vote for an increase in the age, no matter if Obama stands on his head. It's not going to happen.
Right.
So that's really the story in the House. In the Senate, it's somewhat similar. It's a little bit different, but it's how many Democrats will desert the deal. And Jeff Merkley and Bernie Sanders are working overtime to make sure that there are a lot of Democrats that will. And so far, more than a dozen Democrats have absolutely said they will not vote for this compromise if it's on the backs of working families.
Good.
So if they try to raise the age of Medicare and Social Security, that's it. They're not going to vote for it. And there are a lot of Republicans that aren't going for it no matter what. I mean, you're not going to get, some lunatic like Mike Lee from Utah,
mm-hmm.
or not to mention DeMint, who's still voting, obviously.
Right. Rand Paul.
And Ron Johnson has said no, he's not voting for anything. So these people are just no matter what.
Wow.
So in the Senate, Obama and Boehner can't afford to lose big chunks of Democrats, so they're not going to pass this thing. And that looks fairly decent right now.
Right. And the thing is, I mean, in order to get it done by the end of the year, they need to come up with a framework. I think in 2 days, I think the 15th is like the deadline to get it done by the end of the year with all the rules and the votes and the...
They're saying that, the whole, no one goes on vacation. There's going to be a lot of drama coming up in the next week or so. But remember, this is terrorism. The whole invention of the term fiscal cliff, and the way they've gotten the media to present it to the American people,
who aren't
following it as closely as we are, this is a form of terrorism.
Yeah.
They want people to really be terrified. I wrote on my blog. I'm reading this incredible book now about the world in the 900s. Just as the year 1000 approached,
wow.
So the medieval world,
uh-huh.
and there was a time in France where they had a very similar situation to this. It was their fiscal cliff, wasn't a fiscal cliff, but the upper classes came up with this cockamamie story how the world was going to end, and the purpose was to get all of the people in France to be so terrified that they would give up their freedom and become serfs. And they did it. It worked. They terrified everybody the same way that Obama and Boehner are trying to terrify everybody with this fiscal cliff nonsense. They terrified everyone so much that everyone in France voluntarily entered into a state of serfdom for centuries.
Wow. Wow.
So this is where we're headed.
The ruling
classes do. They use their power to perpetuate and expand their power.
Look at Michigan, right? Now, Howie, along these lines, one of the big aspects that of the so-called fiscal thing because in the sequester, this is what has the rights all terrified. In the sequester, it calls for massive cuts to a lot of things that are bad, but to the military budget. Now, I think that's a good thing. They could cut 3/4 of the military budget and we would still outspend every other nation on the planet. So what is the problem here?
Well, it's funny you should bring that up. There are two aspects I want to talk about.
Okay.
The head of the House Armed Services Committee, one of the worst Republicans of all, is Buck McKeon. And Buck McKeon has actually said, and this is, he's a lockstep zombie Republican robot.
Right.
And he has said he doesn't care about not raising taxes on the rich. If you have to cut the military budget, he'd rather raise taxes on the rich. Nothing. He will go nowhere with cutting the military budget. He's hardcore. His career is financed by military contractors and arms manufacturers, and that's also the basis of his power. He has taken more money, Buck McKeon has taken more money in bribes from the military than any two senators, let alone members of Congress. And aside from what he takes himself, he is the one who they come to, like people like Lockheed Martin and Boeing. They go to McKeon and they say, who should we give money to? We have a budget of $1 million for bribes this quarter. And he tells them, give to this guy, give this much to this guy, give this much to this guy. So he has a lot of power tied up in this. So that's one side. Now I want to go exactly to the other side. I don't know if you saw this or not. It's the first story on my blog this morning. I just wrote a piece about it. But Keith Ellison, one of the most liberal members of Congress, he's the co-chair with Raul Grijalva of the Progressive Caucus, and he's from Minnesota.
Mm-hmm.
Keith and a very, very, very conservative, teabag-oriented Republican from South Carolina named Mick Mulvaney got together and put out a letter, which they just sent to Boehner and Reid and Pelosi and Obama, you know, the whole crew of them. They sent a letter saying, look, if you're going into this these grand bargain negotiations now, please include the military budget. There are a lot of cuts to be made to that military budget, and that should be part of the savings that you're looking for to balance the budget.
Wow.
And what's amazing about the letter is it's been signed by 11 Democrats and 11 Republicans. And it includes some very, very senior Democrats who have a lot of power, you know, like, you know, committee chairman and people who have been around for a really long time, people who are very, very well-respected, like, Jerry Nadler is one of the signatories.
Mm-hmm.
Barbara Lee is one of the uh-huh. signatories. Ed Markey is a signatory. I mean, some really good, solid Democrats have signed it, and some of the real crackpots among the Republicans have signed it as well. So 11 Republicans signed this thing, and then 11 Democrats. So this is, to me, where, you know, the Republicans and the Republican establishment and the Democratic establishment are the real problem in a lot of things that we face in the country right now. And the two establishments have more in common with each other than they do with American working families. So I don't really trust the Democratic establishment. I don't really trust the Republican, mm-hmm. obviously, establishment. But to see Democrats and Republicans going around their leaders and around the establishment to come together on something as common sense as this, that gives me some hope, some tiny modicum of hope that maybe Congress will be worth something. Now, here we have 22 members, 11 from each party, trying to do something that's massive. That doesn't mean it's going to happen. But at least there's an effort, a bipartisan effort, and there are lots and lots and lots of people who didn't sign this thing who would sign it in a second. I mean, obviously tons of Democrats, but I know of Republicans who didn't sign it who would sign it as well, or who would back it.
That's pretty big news. Now the question is, will this gain traction? I mean, are they going to be able to get more than 11 on each side?
Yes, they will. I mean, I think that they wanted the symmetry, which is why they didn't have, you know, 75 Democrats and 11 Republicans.
Right.
I don't know if it's going to take the day, but it's a good battle to fight and a good battle to try to win, because, you know, ending the war is something that is making a lot of sense. I don't know if you watched Rachel Maddow or not last night, but she was pointing out how the more Americans we're sending over there, all the result is more Americans are getting killed.
Yeah.
And violence has increased, not decreased. And the outcomes are actually worse. The more we've amped up the war, the more the Obama surge went into play, the worse things have gotten by every measurement. So people should be thinking now about, like, you know, saying to Obama, okay, dude, we gave you your shot, it's over,
mm-hmm.
we're all finished now.
Right.
And Democrats who were reluctant to do that before the election because they didn't want to harm his chances to beat Romney, they don't have that problem now. Now they've got to go for it. And I think that is something that is going to be possible, because in order for Obama to keep this war going, he depends on Republican votes. He doesn't have the Democratic votes he needs to keep the war going, especially not now. So, and the Republicans are pretty pissed off about this. You know, they know that they're going to lose this grand bargain thing, and they're angry that tax rates are going to go up on their billionaires and multimillionaires. They're really pissed. So they'll take it out on Obama in every way, including possibly the war. We'll see.
But I know many of them want the war to end, too. And now I would like to not only bring that money home, but cut the massive amounts we spend on, you know, weapons building and stuff like that. Howie, then there's the other question.
You have two schools of thought there, mm-hmm. in both parties. You know, one of them is there's a lot of, you know, they get a cut. These Republicans and Democrats in Congress, they get a cut of that money that gets spent
on guns.
That's
they
want that. They want it. I mean, and there are Republicans and there are Democrats for whatever reason. I mean, the Republicans would like to see taxes go down. Democrats would like to see social spending and infrastructure spending and stimulus.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why they'd like to see less money spent on the Pentagon. So they were both. They both have reasons why they want it. But then on the other hand, there are members of both parties who want more spending, not less spending.
Right, because
that's why I brought up Buck McKeon in the beginning of the conversation.
Sure, sure. Now, the question about the taxes that I want to ask you, because we hear so much about raising the marginal tax rates on the top 2%, which is all well and good. I think they should go back to the Clinton era rates, if not higher.
Right.
Why
not the Eisenhower?
Or bigger. That's what I'm saying. At least Clinton era rates. I don't know why, you know, the people are fighting against that. But more important than that, I think, is the doing something about the tax rates on capital gains and dividends. And is that even part of this discussion?
It is.
Is it?
Okay. As is the estate tax. You know, there are other things that people aren't talking about. I mean, I think very few people realize that when the Bush tax cuts expire on December 31st, so does the deal that was made in during the lame duck in 2010 that extended the estate tax.
Right.
And that will go rocketing sky high.
To what?
So they have to come up with a new plan for that as well.
Where does that go to?
And they are working on it. So let me give you a horrible number.
Okay.
I mean, you know, as you know, I'm not a big fan of Obama's, to put it very mildly.
Right.
In fact, I think he's a horribly mediocre president.
Yep.
But this is the kind of reform that Obama tries to do. So right now, 2 out of 1,000 estates have to pay any tax at all. So 1,000 estates, the guy dies, two of those estates wind up paying an estate tax. Two.
Wow.
So Obama wants to reform that. What's Obama's reform? 3 out of 1,000 will have to pay, and not a very good rate, a fairly low rate. I mean, this is outrageous. It is, and it's typical Obama. That's how it goes. I mean, there are so many things that he could be doing now. He could be having, if he were a good negotiator, which he's not, he's a terrible negotiator.
Yep.
And if he had the best interests of working families in mind, he could have the Republicans begging on their hands and knees, begging for the Clinton tax rates. That's what they should be doing.
That's right.
They should be begging him to bring back the Clinton rates. But he is a bad negotiator.
Yep.
He starts with that. That isn't a very, that's not a, there's a much, much better way to do that. And there's a much better, you know, and the things like what you said, I mean, look, let's look at it like this. How about creating a new category, one for people who make over $1 million,
right,
or over $5 million, or over $10 million,
right,
or over $1 billion?
Yeah.
How about rates for them?
Exactly.
How about any money over $10 million gets taxed at 50% or 80%?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, one of the problems is that, you know, there was a time when society, as an American society, had decided we don't want to be a plutocracy. We don't want an aristocracy of birth ruling this country and taking over the country. And at that point, and certainly during FDR's time and during Eisenhower's time, there was a tax rate that enforced that idea.
Mm-hmm.
You couldn't. There could be no massive intergenerational fortunes made in the United States. And that was a very, very good and very, very healthy thing. And it was also the time of the greatest growth of the middle class, and the country prospered more than it had ever prospered before. But under Kennedy and subsequent presidents, that went away. And suddenly, No one has any problem with plutocrats. No one has any problem with aristocracies of birth taking over the United States. And that is what the root of the problem is. And Obama's not there. He doesn't seem to care that that's happening. He's certainly not addressing it in any way in any of the proposals he's making. And I feel that that is a very, very, that's a dagger at the heart of democracy. I have a post about this subject coming out this afternoon.
Oh, cool. Well, I'll make sure to link to it on my blog at RadioOrNot.com. It's a fascinating topic, and one that, this is the important stuff that we're really not hearing about. Howie Klein, let me throw you a question way out of left field. If Hillary Clinton doesn't run in 2016 and Joe Biden doesn't run, Who is there? Who's good? I wouldn't want to see one of them.
Those are two very, very different questions. Who is there and who's good?
Right. Well, yes.
First of all, which do you want me to answer? Who's there or who's good?
Both.
Well, who's there, unfortunately, is some really not very good Democrats. You've got the governor of New York.
No! Andrew Cuomo.
Cuomo, who's pretty awful.
No, I loved his father, but he is no Mario. Andrew is no Mario. Okay.
Yeah, you've got him. You've got the governor of Maryland, who's a little bit better than him, but
Martin
not great.
O'Malley, right?
You've got Kirsten Gillibrand,
and
the senator from New York, and she's I don't know what she is. I know Kirsten as well. I've known her for a number of years. I don't know her well, but I know her, and I don't trust her.
Right.
She's pretty good with her positions now. She was pretty awful when she was first elected.
Right.
To
she used to be a real blue dog, and now she seems immediately became a more
blue
progressive.
Dog.
Right. I know.
So I think she'd just be another Obama at the best. But on the other hand, I think America is totally ready for a woman president. I think whoever runs a credible woman for president is going to win, whichever party runs a credible woman. And the Democrats better keep that in mind. Obviously, the dream candidate for progressives would be Elizabeth Warren.
Right. And I
remember,
guess,
when Obama ran for president, he had been a senator
for
exactly
years?
The same amount of time by the day that
Elizabeth Warren
will have been a senator if she decides to run. So he was a senator for 2 years and he ran for president. She will have been a senator for 2 years. She also had a much, much, much bigger, not even close, national reputation than he did.
Right.
I mean, Elizabeth Warren is very, very much known and revered and loved by a lot of people. When Obama first ran, Barack Obama, what is he, an Israeli-Irish person? You know, and people didn't know who he was or anything about him. He had come from being a rather obscure state senator in Illinois.
Howie, you know what?
Who he was. She, on the other hand, has been making headlines for a number of
years
and in a really good way.
David just pointed out something to me. Actually, no, because she was elected in 2012, and the next presidential election is in 2016, not 2014. So she'll have been in office for almost four years. Right. So
yes,
even two years more in the Senate than President Obama had, which gives her more time there.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thanks, David.
Thanks, David. now I owe him for that. I always have to pay up when he gives me, you know. Anyway, so I know. Look, I was saying that before she ran for Senate. I think and with Elizabeth Warren being named on the banking committee, she can do some real good here. As long as the Obama people don't get to her.
Right. Yeah. Well, you noticed that yesterday they balanced that, they balanced putting her on that committee.
With Joe Manchin?
Putting Joe Manchin
on
the committee.
Oh, my God.
There is no Democrat, none, who's as bad a corporate shill and a total slave to the banking interest than Joe Manchin. So by putting him on the committee, they can go to the bankers and say, look, we balanced her vote. He'll cancel her out.
Right, yeah.
That's not why they're afraid of her being on the committee.
Right.
It's not about a vote. It's about a way of thinking and a determination and an absolute incorruptibility. I mean, I look forward to the next time that Jamie Dimon is subpoenaed in front of that committee.
Yeah, I'll tell you one part on the concert last night that you're lucky you missed. I guess Chase was one of the big sponsors, as was Who knows? But they were like, Billy Crystal was kissing up to Chase. They all were. And one of them made a really bad joke about, you know, Jamie Dimon. You know why his name is Dimon? Because he has grills on his teeth. What? Yeah. All right. So if they did the right thing by sponsoring this movie last night, or this concert last night, to allow them to raise money for Sandy relief, let Chase come in and you know, give some people rip up their mortgages or something.
Yeah,
you know,
I go for that.
Yeah,
yeah. I mean, they didn't. I doubt that Chase, you know, sponsored it out of the goodness of their heart.
Exactly.
I mean, I'm sure they sponsored it because they saw it as an opportunity to push forward the whatever agenda it is that their advertising department is trying to push forward.
Yep.
It's as simple as that.
Exactly. All right. Well, Howie Klein, we're just about out of time. You're getting ready to go to India. Have a wonderful time. Will you be blogging and tweeting while you're gone?
Of course.
All right. Well, we'll see. We'll follow you online, and we'll talk to you when you get back.
Thanks. Good to talk to you. Have a good Christmas and New Year's.
Thank you. The same to you, and travel safely.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Watch out for those TSA guys because, you know, they can get fresh. Howie Klein, find him at downwithtyranny.com on Twitter, @downwithtyranny. Coming up, it is Thursday. Maysoon Zayid will be with us. Maysoon has been tweeting before her visit with us this morning. She is at the dentist. Bad planning. And when we bring Maysoon on, we'll also have Boca Brittany. Boca, who is a huge Maysoon fan. In fact, when we did our little audition show with George Rodriguez, Boca, and myself on Monday, Boca just wanted Maysoon, and I kept trying to reach her, but she was, I don't know where she was. She was flying back from Los Angeles, I think. Anyway, so we'll get the two of them together so they can bond, all right? We also have some of the highlights one of the highlights from last night's concert and, you know, and all that. But first, the news.
I read the news today, oh boy.
And for that, I think we turned to the Talk Radio News Service, talkradionews.com. Is it Ellen Ratner today?
It is Ellen Ratner today.
Ellen Ratner. Good morning. I understand you. So you didn't watch the concert last night, huh?
I didn't. I didn't even know it was in existence.
Oh, my God.
Is that bad?
That's bad. Pop culture, Ellen. You got to.
I know. You know, somebody said to me, well, I think I probably turn on the TV twice a year.
Wow.
And now the one program I used to watch, 60 Minutes, I can get it online.
Yeah. Everything you can, well, you can't get everything online, but most of the shows you can, and you can watch them at your own convenience.
That's what I actually do.
Yeah. It's modern technology, and it's
interesting, and I think that, you know, that makes me nervous because it makes us all the more vulnerable on several things in terms of, you know, anybody who wants to mess with our systems, all that kind of thing.
Well, that is true. And I did an interview on that not too long ago. I mean, the chances of, look, you know, this all goes hand in hand with the military spending, which I think is so out of date because the new attacks are going to be electromagnetic and not with a troop invasion on the ground. That's, you know, it's a different world now. So
I don't know if you remember, she's been around a long time, Blanquita Cullum. She was a conservative
I've met her, right?
host.
Uh-huh.
And then she became, she was Bush nominee to the Broadcasting Board of Governors and all that kind of
right.
stuff. And Blanquita said 15 years ago,
uh-huh.
she said, the next world war is going to be fought on that, well, at that
yes.
point it was a box
right.
on your, and of course, she's absolutely correct.
Yep. Well, it's true. All the more reason why the right-wing terror, you know, alert on the fact that the military budget might be slashed if the sequester is triggered. That's the least of our worries. Worry about hurting poor people by cutting back on social programs. We can afford to slash the military budget and then, you know, use that money to put people to work doing constructive things rather than destructive things.
That would be nice.
Wouldn't it? In a perfect world.
Well, it's interesting. Today, Nancy Pelosi, John Boehner, and the Senate Democrats are all having press conferences.
Okay.
So I don't know what those press conferences are going to be, but you can bet they're all dealing with the finances issue.
I'm sure they are. And I retweeted something a few minutes ago. Brian Beutler of Talking Points Memo, who was, quote, Pelosi, quote, don't even think of raising the Medicare age. And I retweeted that because that's got to be what everybody's saying right now. There is no reason on earth to raise the Medicare age. You know what? You want to save money for Medicare? Lower the Medicare eligibility age. Get healthier people into the system. It'll save more money.
Well, that should be that's absolutely true. And people, you know, I think I've talked to you before that my rate as of January 1st goes up to $2,000.
Amazing.
$41 a month,
yeah.
Which is more than I pay for rent.
Right.
In D.C.
Oh,
I
my
mean,
God.
And that's D.C.
That's ridiculous. Right. And, you know, and to make matters worse, I mean, I had a long talk with Bob Ney here yesterday, who called in with the news, who doesn't have health coverage. This is criminal. And if we can't get health insurance at 60, how are we going to get it at 66 and 67?
We're not.
Exactly.
I
mean, so you're going to have more
Obamacare
uninsured.
Obamacare really does make those provisions.
Right. So it'll be available to us, but it doesn't mean it'll be affordable to us.
Well, it is called the Affordable
Health
Care Act,
I know.
And they are trying to make it affordable.
Right. Yeah, but we'll have to wait and see how it plays out. But without a public option, look, I have a problem with still paying that extra 17% that goes to the overhead of the for-profit insurance industry. I'd rather pay the nonprofit 3% Medicare overhead than the 20% of United Healthcare.
Yeah, United's the big bad guys. They're
right.
My bad guys.
That me too. And we pay over $1,000 a month each for myself and for David. So, you know, for two of us, we are over $2,000 a month. And as I said, then we have a $2,000 deductible before insurance kicks in a dime. It's government-sanctioned extortion. I've been saying this for years, and that's why we should have had a public option at the very least. At the best, what we should have had is Medicare for all. Let us just buy into the program.
And let us buy in, exactly. This would not be rocket science.
No. And, you know, furthermore, and I'm hearing finally some of the members of Congress say this, why are we not talking about letting Medicare negotiate with the drug companies on drug prices as the VA does? When I look at what my medications cost, and I'm dreading...
Because it's called the drug lobby in Washington, D.C.
Yeah, but January kicks in, and then not only do I have to meet my deductible, I have to start paying the pre-deductible cost of these medications, and I don't have a job. I mean, the whole thing is, you know, and I'm wondering why I'm getting sick again. It's stress.
Right, and we also know that stress and cancer are very closely connected.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Not necessarily the first time, but on repeat times, it is.
Yeah. Wow.
I mean, often on the first time, it can be environmental.
Right. Well, I'm a cancer survivor. I had malignant melanoma. So, you know, I'm at risk, and that's why I have this pre-existing condition, and that's why it's so hard to get insurance. And when I can, it's so expensive.
I mean, we'll just see if they can manage this. And now... I mean, get it together. What is one more week of negotiations going to do?
Keep them all from going home. Right?
Yeah.
Right?
Exactly.
Well, you know, and what I'm hoping is, look, that they don't get it done. And then they finally say, let's go home. We'll just deal with it in the 113th Congress when it's, you know, there are more Democrats and certainly more progressives.
Well, I would hope. But.
Yep.
What's happening, you know, is interesting because yesterday, there was an accusation made by Chris Van Hollen. He said that the speaker doesn't have the votes to be speaker. He's concerned, and that's why he's slow-mowing this until he's elected speaker on January 3rd. I don't think that's the case. I think he's got the votes. Yes, there are some right-wing factions there, but they got rid of a lot of those guys. I mean, the Tea Party people.
Right. No, they did. And you know, some of the Blue Dogs actually were voted out, too. However, we now have, you know, the new Dems. The new Dems are just the 2012 version of the Blue Dogs. So,
well, some are, some aren't.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, whatever. By the way, I have to ask you: have you heard from your buddy, Mr. Alan West?
Oh no! Just the latest I saw from him is when he did an interview with Mark Levin, saying that the only way they could beat him was to cheat. Really? Because
is that really what he was saying?
That's what he said. That's a direct quote. They had to cheat to beat him. No, excuse me. If he thought they cheated, he didn't have to concede. They were recounting the votes at his request, even though they weren't required to by law.
He could have gotten the Republicans on his side.
Yep, and he still had plenty of money.
There would have been a lot of pressure.
That's right.
I mean, you're in Florida, after all.
That's right. And he still had money. And look, when they started counting more ballots at his request, the margin of his loss got larger. So, you know, he's just...
Mark my words, he's going to try and run again.
Oh, of course he will. Of course. Well, the question is, from what district? He's going to go somewhere else where he thinks it'll be even easier for him to win? He needs to just give it up.
Well, I don't think we've heard the last from Alan West.
No, I don't think we have either. I'm surprised he hasn't turned up on Fox yet.
Oh, he will, in some respect.
I'm sure.
We'll see him doing something.
Oh, yeah. Vacation relief, maybe. anything else going on?
I think the only other interesting thing is I want to also ask you about this. It's in your great state of Florida, which is the McAfee. I never pronounced
McAfee, it right?
Is McAfee, it McAfee, right? McAfee. And what's he's up to?
I don't know. I really don't know. Let me see. My friend Jim DeFede, who he now works for CBS, the local CBS station, and he's been tweeting about it this morning. There's a picture of McAfee on South Beach. Let's see. John McAfee facing federal investigation into possible money laundering and tax evasion. IRS agent spoke to him at Miami International Airport. Says McAfee could also face questions by FBI over the death of American citizen in Belize who was his neighbor.
Yeah, this is the guy he's accused of killing.
Wow.
He's not totally accused of killing, but he is, quote-unquote, a person of interest.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know, but a good person to follow on this story is Jim DeFede, DeFede on Twitter.
Oh, I will love to do that.
Yeah.
So, believe it or not, through all these press conferences, today is also the White House basement Christmas party.
Oh, really?
This has been going on for about 20 years, and... a friend of mine actually covered the White House and said to another friend of mine, oh, well, you know, Ellen Rander, she's just at the basement. And she was a print person. The point is that in the basement are the lesser TV networks,
radio?
The magazine and radio.
Of course.
And we do our own basement Christmas party every year.
Cool.
And we've started to invite the upstairs.
Oh, ooh, okay. I would be happy to go into the basement, you know.
Well, next time you're here, you should come do your show from there.
Oh, I would love to. Can I do that from the basement
of the
White House?
We have ISDN and all that kind of stuff.
Okay, yay. Okay, cool. It's a deal. I will definitely do that.
Oh, yeah, we'd love to have you.
One more question. This week and the last week or so, we've been seeing the farewell speeches from the retiring members of Congress. I understand Joe Lieberman did his farewell yesterday.
Yes, Lieberman did a farewell speech. It's true.
Any surprises other than the weird thing with Harry Reid talking about Ben Nelson's hair? That was weird.
No. There haven't been any real surprises. And, you know, this is their last chance to sort of say what they're going to say and get on C-SPAN and go into the dark of night. I do think that Joe Lieberman is probably going to start some foundation or something.
Okay.
So I'm pretty sure I've heard that via the grapevine.
All right. Well, we'll watch out for that. Oh, look at this. The Walton family's holiday bonus, $677,767,720. Walmart worker holiday bonus, zero.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Where'd you find that?
Somebody just tweeted this. Let me see what the... Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
They're bit.ly/Walmart holiday.
Oh, my gosh.
And there's a graphic there. Bit.ly/Walmart holiday. Go check it out. Staggering. The Corporate Action Network and the other 98%.
Stagging.
Yes.
Staggering.
Disgusting. Disgusting.
You'll have Victoria tomorrow. We are off between Christmas and New Year's unless they're back in town.
Oh, okay. All right.
We'll come up with something.
Cool. Well, thank you very much. If I don't talk to you, very happy holidays to you. Bye.
Thank you.
You take care. Ellen Ratner from the Talk Radio News Service at talkradionews.com. All right. I'm not here tomorrow because, you know, I don't do a show on Fridays. But next week, I start filling in for Randy Rhodes. I'm in for Randy from Monday through the end of the year, obviously, except for the weekends and Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. But aside from that, I'll be in for Randy Rhodes. So make a note of that. Be sure to listen each day. And I'll be doing most of these shows. I may have Jacob Dean come in and fill in a little bit. But I will do that. I will do, I'll do double duty most days. But Jacob Dean, again, will hopefully take over a couple of times. All right, so just check in. We'll have a show every day regardless, okay? Okay, we're going to do our regular year in review, rear view, year in review thing. Somehow we may shake it up a little bit and do it by topic rather than chronologically. I don't know. We'll figure it out. We'll get it together. Stay tuned, okay? All right. Stick around. Still to come on this Thursday morning show, we've got Maysoon Zaid coming up and Boca Brittany, who really wants to meet Maysoon. So all that on the way and Adam Sandler's take on Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah from last night's 12-12-12 concert. So stick around. Really, don't go away. Nicole Sandler, Radio or Not.
At goatsfortheoldgoat.com, you can buy a goat to fight hunger in South Sudan and help recently liberated slaves from the north come to their peaceful home in the south. We'll send you a certificate acknowledging your gift and a photo of your goat with its recipient upon delivery. Even better, you can make the donation in the name of your special someone as a present they'll never forget. So visit goatsfortheoldgoat.com today and help fight hunger this holiday season. That's goatsfortheoldgoat.com.
This is the Media Matters Minute. I'm Bradley Herring. Anti-worker legislation passed in Michigan on Tuesday, weakening the ability of unions to bargain for the rights of workers. Members of the right-wing media have pushed numerous myths about the pro-corporate policy. On Fox Business, Lou Dobbs joined in.
And what this law changes is forced union membership. So why is the president and why are the unions so upset? Well, in this case, it is about the money, specifically union dues. Less money obviously means less political power.
But the truth is that under federal labor law, forced union membership is already illegal, and unions cannot force non-members to pay fees that go to political activity. What Dobbs failed to mention is that the Michigan law gives some non-union members a free ride. The unions still negotiate on their behalf, but the workers won't pay for that weakened protection. For more facts on worker rights and other stories, please visit MediaMatters.org.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Adam Sandler. That's my friend, Mr. Paul Schaefer. That's okay. I'll do it without the guitar. Cool. We're honored to be here tonight raising money for the capital of the world, my hometown. Okay, here we go. Don't worry, I'm cool. The terror of the hurricane, the unforgiving wind and rain. New York, the world held its breath as the storm took it to you. But you've been knocked down in the past, taking shots they thought would last. But you always get right up, shouting hallelujah, hallelujah. Sandy, screw ya, we'll get through ya, cause we're New Yorkers. Yeah, New York, you've dealt with crap before, like squeegee men and tunnel whores, and restaurant delivery biking, right through you. The puke on your stoops every Sunday morn. Times Square losing all its porn. Original Ray's pizza closing to you. But hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Sandy, screw you.
Screw ya!
We'll get through you.
We'll get through ya.
Cause we're New Yorkers. Cause we believe this too shall pass. Like when Sanchez fumbled into an ass. And during the playoffs, A-Rod telling girls in the crowd, I wanna do ya. The Mets have sucked since 86. Isaiah tried to ruin the Knicks. But now Jason Kidd and the boys can freaking school you. Hallelujah. Sandy, screw you. Let me hear you. We'll get through you. Cause we're new. The bed bugs scare of 2010. The low hands getting busted again and again. The lady who said she was a man right after she blew ya. Sorry, that was just me. Trump's comb over always making us sick. The congressman who tweeted his dick. The mayor's ban on 32 ounce Mountain Dew you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Sandy, screw ya.
Screw ya.
We'll freaking kung fu ya.
Kung fu ya.
Cause we're New Yorkers. And Jersey, you taking your share of hits. The situation always showing his tits. The turnpike exit 13 stinking like poo ya. You lost the Nets and now they're good. But we're still the Hudson Brotherhood. Together we'll give Sandy a big fuckooler. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Connecticut to ya!
To ya!
We'll get through ya!
We'll get through ya!
Cause we're new!
Sort of cuts out. Yeah, but very funny. Although I got to tell you, listening to Adam Sandler sing like that hurts my throat. He always, his voice. Anyway, a couple of other TV things for you before we move on. The Barbara Walters special apparently was on last night. In fact, Panora in the chat room says something that Barbara Walters special came on at 9:30 last night. And Barbara Walters, one of the people that she had on the special, I didn't see it, obviously, I was watching the concert, was Governor, New Jersey Governor Chris Christie, who was there in the crowd. They waved. He and Andrew Cuomo were both there. And Barbara Walters apparently asked Chris Christie if he's too fat to be president. Seriously.
Okay, Governor. I feel very uncomfortable asking this question when I'm sitting opposite you. But you are a little overweight.
More than a little.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why?
Why?
If I could figure that out, I'd fix it. No.
There are people who say that you couldn't be president because you're so heavy. What do you say to them?
No, it's ridiculous. I mean, that's ridiculous. I mean, I don't know what the basis for that is.
I think they're worried about your health.
Well, I've done this job pretty well, and I think people watched me for the last number of weeks in Hurricane Sandy doing 18-hour days and getting right back up the next day and still being just as effective in the job. So I don't really think that would be a problem.
Okay. Really, Barbara Walters? Are you too fat to be president? Look, he might. I still remember the video. I remember a helicopter took him to his son's football game. And then he had to have a car drive him from the helicopter to the stands because I guess he's too fat to make the walk. But he got around okay, waddling behind Obama during all the Sandy stuff. Why are you fat? Why am I overweight? It shit, you know, what? I guess he hasn't gone through menopause, but you know, really? Wow. But that wasn't the most offensive question on television yesterday. Seriously, it wasn't the most offensive question on television yesterday. Now, I didn't know about this until I read a piece about it. But Matt Lauer on the Today Show yesterday interviewed Anne Hathaway. Now, I really like Anne Hathaway. I've liked her since The Princess Diaries. I like her. I think she's good. And I've liked her even more since I saw her marching on the streets of New York in an Occupy Wall Street protest with a sign supporting the teachers. Good for her. Apparently, you know, she stars in Les Mis, the new movie version of Les Miserables. And apparently she was going to a premiere and she was getting out of a car and paparazzi shot a picture of her crotch, her pantyless crotch. Again, I don't pay attention to that shit, so I didn't know it was out there, but apparently it was, and then, you know, they sold the pictures to the, you know, to the rags, and so this went around. So Matt Lauer has an Academy Award nominated actress on the Today Show, got the arguably one of the biggest movies of the year opening, right? Robert Hill says, commonly referred to as going commando, right? And so this is what Matt Lauer says to her. First thing, he welcomes her to the show and says, oh, hold on, I need to do this. Here we go.
Anne Hathaway, good morning. Nice to see you.
Good morning, Matt.
Seen a lot of you lately.
Sorry about that.
Oh, my God. Seen a lot of you lately? That's Anne Hathaway. Welcome to the show. We've seen a lot of you lately. Seriously?
To see you.
Good morning, Matt.
Seen a lot of you lately.
Sorry about that.
You were.
I'd be happy to stay home, but the film.
Let's just get it out of the way. You had a little wardrobe malfunction.
What?
The other
Why
night.
Is
What's
this
the
a
lesson
question?
Learned from something
what?
Like that?
What? Lesson
other than
learned?
That you keep smiling, which you always do.
Wear panties?
Well,
what?
It
minds your own fucking
an
business.
Unfortunate incident.
Yeah.
I think it kind of made me sad on two
you
accounts.
Think?
One was that I was very sad that we live in an age when someone takes a picture of another person in a vulnerable moment and rather than delete it and do the decent thing, sells it. And I'm sorry that we live in a culture that commodifies sexuality of unwilling participants, which brings us back to Les Mis,
exactly,
because that's
right.
What my character is. She is someone who is forced to sell sex to benefit her child because she has nothing and there's no social safety net. And I, yeah, so... So let's get back to Les Mis.
That's the question I have ever heard, and I'm going to take it at that. That's fine.
No, that was her telling you, fuck you. Why are you bringing this up? You sexist piece of shit. How about we talk about the movie? And then apparently, and I didn't know this either again because I don't read the gossip magazines, but Anne Hathaway lost a lot of weight for this role because she was dying. She got really unhealthily skinny. And apparently she doesn't like to talk about the weight loss because she thinks Hollywood and the magazines and the fashion industry glamorizes skinniness, right? And she doesn't want to promote that as a healthy lifestyle. And so, of course, he asks her about it.
As someone who has worked out next to you at a gym,
yeah,
you do not have 25 pounds to lose. I mean, how did you even go about that?
Oh, you don't want to know. Honestly, it would just, I think it's upsetting to talk about.
That way? It was really just nothing? Deprivation? Or worse? Okay.
She doesn't want to go there.
Good.
She doesn't.
Not worse, but, you know, I get nervous talking about it because I find that I don't want to be seen as trying to glamorize it. There's a lot of talk, a lot of pressure, especially on young girls to lose weight.
Right.
And what I did was not like, I didn't do it to get hot. Like, I did it to look like I was dying. And
right.
So I just don't want to be seen as in talking about it,
so
giving more attention than it's.
Don't try this at home.
Do not try this at home. Exactly.
I didn't do it to get hot. I did it to look like I was dying. Now, you know, wow. Good for her for putting Matt Lauer in his place. Right? Right. Okay. All right. Now, Thursday mornings around this time, we usually have Maysoon Zaid on, and we're going to get Maysoon on. But before we bring her on, let me see if I've got him up on the Twitters. Oh, her. Sorry. Brit, Boca Brit, where are you? I hope she accepted me, my contact request on the Twitter. I'm not on the Twitter, on the Skype. Yeah. Okay. Is this going to work? I don't know. Well, we'll try. Let's see. Call. No? Is this going to work? I don't know. We'll try. We're trying to call Boca Brit. Boca Brittany, the woman formerly known as Boca. Oh, are you there? Boca?
Hi.
Hi. Oh, this is working. You were
working. Oh, it's working and it's free.
Yay. We love free.
Good.
All right. So this is Boca. I wanted to get you on before we got Maysoon on the line, just so we can chat for a minute or so here.
Yeah, I saw her tweets. I guess it's a mystery to her.
There's a mystery to her?
She said, who's mysterious Boca Brit?
Oh,
on her tweet.
Okay. Well, we'll have to introduce you. She does know your the intro that you made for her. So we'll do that. But, you know, when we did the show together on Monday, our little audition show, you were asking if I could get Maysoon on the line. You call her Maysoon, though. Pronounce her name for me, how you say?
Days, I'll get her name right. I'm an idiot.
No, you're not an idiot, but that's okay. You've never met Maysoon, so I get to introduce you to. But I'm glad to have you on here first for a couple of minutes because the people in the chat room are big fans. Robert Hale in New York City says, welcome, Boca. Love your comedy bits. It's the first time you've been on my show. I mean, your work has been here before, but the first time you've been here. And you know what? I'm going to play one that I don't think I've played yet, all right? I should probably do it with Maysoon here because it's the Gaza Strip joint, and we'll get her thoughts on it. How about that?
It's not a true story, by the way.
It is?
Yes, there actually was a strip joint where the strippers performed that act that's in the bit. So.
Okay. Well, then, you know what? Let's get Maysoon on because why not? We just can. But bear with me because I got to find her on my contact list. In the meantime, you can find Boca Brittany at thebocashow.com, right?
That is correct.
The Boca.
By the way, for having me today. I love being here.
Oh, God. I'm happy to have you here. I got to find Maysoon. Where are you, Maysoon? Hold on. I'm going to try it a different way because... you know, they updated Skype not too long ago, and it really, I have a hard time navigating it. All right, let's see if it'll work this way. Here we go. Add to conference call. All right, so we're calling Maysoon. In fact, let me play this.
You know, I had this crazy aunt that lived in Jersey.
And nobody wants to hear that. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, now with the news from New Jersey, Maysoon Zayed.
Yeah. Love it. All right. Now, hopefully she'll be picking up any second. Now, she's a little slow on the picking up the phone. You know, she's dealing with the stuff. Hello? Doesn't look like it's working. Maysoon? We don't even hear the ringing, but it looks like she hasn't picked it. This is such great radio, isn't it? Ah! All right. I don't know why it's not working. All right. I'm going to try one more time because that didn't go through. See, this is what I get for trying to attempt technical feats that I haven't done before.
You think she's still at the dentist, maybe?
No, because she tweeted. Hold on. Let's see. She wrote, dentistry and palsy. Excellent for radio. Don't know. And I don't know if it's ringing, because usually we can hear the phone ringing in the background. But we don't hear it. You know what? We'll give her another minute or two. I will play that bit. So, you know, if she's listening in the background, she can hear it. So set this up. So there really was a strip joint in Gaza that prompted this bit?
No, it wasn't in Gaza. It was close, though. It was in Miami. And
okay.
You know, I think it was in prestigious Hialeah. It was one of our accounts back at WQAM. And it's gone now, so I can say the name. It was Treasure Island. Mm-hmm. And one of the star acts of this place was a stripper who would shoot ping pong balls out of her thing.
Okay. Oh. So. Okay. So here you go, a Boca production.
Sitting here, la la, waiting for my yaya.
When you want to get your yayas looking at some yabas, go to the Gaza strip joint. That is. Hello, I'm Joey Gaza, owner and proprietor of the Gaza Strip Joint. Invite Muse to come on down to the Gaza Strip, where we feature a wide range of talented girls that can perform amazing acts with a dollar bill or in one of our plushly appointed back rooms. This week's headliner at the Gaza is Zsa Zsa. You're going to love this one, guys. She squirts grenades out of her thing. Ooh. So get your yayas at the Gaza.
Gaza Strip Joint, located just 1 mile east of the industrial complex across from the abandoned Sinclair Station.
That was a highly paid sponsor, I might add.
That was a what?
Oh, the highly paid sponsor.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Wow. Okay. How do you come up with the idea for your bits? You just watch the news and you think in a twisted kind of way and...
Observation, whatever strikes me, I write it down. I take copious notes.
Mm-hmm.
I use the Steve Allen method. I don't know if you recall. He would write everything down and keep a pad next to him when he was asleep, when he was driving, whatever it was. Something hit him. He'd write it all down. And how many times has that happened to you when you have a great idea when you're out on driving or something and you can't remember it when you get back?
All the time. All the time. I'll tell you, I have my best ideas in the shower. I do. I think, all right, I'm going to remember this. And I don't. I have, you know, it's that short-term memory thing. And so I always forget.
Especially in a shower.
I know, because there's nowhere to write it, you know.
What I was just thinking about. Okay, let me make sure. It's Maysoon?
Maysoon.
Maysoon. Maysoon.
Maysoon. And in fact, you know, I just tweeted to her, are you home? And I'm not getting an answer. I don't know.
She got scared.
Say what?
She's a scared. She doesn't know who I am.
No, but she's not scared of anything. Now, do you know Maysoon from seeing her on Olbermann? I mean, or just from hearing her on my show?
If it wasn't for Olbermann, I wouldn't know who she is.
Okay. So right. If it wasn't for Olbermann, I wouldn't know who she was.
Okay.
I was introduced to her by Keith Olbermann, and then, you know, we became buddies on the Twitter. And, you know, now she's my pal.
Well, I thank him for that because she's brilliant.
Mm-hmm. She is, although she's missing in action because she's supposed to be here, but she's not answering me on the Twitter machine. All right. Maybe she got too much nitrous oxide at the dentist or something. All right. So for people who don't know, look, we talked about this on Monday. We did a little audition show for a station here in Miami that's looking for a new afternoon show. I sent everything off. I got emails back that said, thanks, just so you know. So that would be nice. But for those who don't know, they've heard your work here on the show. They've heard your work with George Rodriguez, maybe with Neil Rogers. But we talked about this Monday, but we'll bring it up again. They knew you as Boca Bryan. And then all of a sudden, one day, I saw you and you like said, hey, Nicole, it's me. But you were Brittany, Boca Brittany. This wasn't something that you just woke up one day and said, you know what, I'm sick of being a guy. I'm gonna become a girl.
Yes, that's exactly what happened.
Really?
Yeah, I woke up one day. I said, screw this. I'm going to be a girl. The caveat being that I do it correctly and make the appropriate amount of research and homework, and this is the result. I've been a lot happier person ever since.
Right. Now, this is something that you had done, but. Not publicly before, yes?
Well, with the exception, your audience probably doesn't know Neil Rogers, but
right.
I was on the Neil Rogers show for 20 years in 1988 when I started with Neil on the show. And of course, George came along a year later at WYOD. But in 2000, that's when I came out of the closet, so to speak. And everybody pretty much knew except for Neil, who was outwardly gay on the air, and he could not know that I was transgender, just so he wouldn't make waves.
Isn't that weird? I mean, here's a guy who early, I mean, very early on, came out on the radio at a time when it wasn't fashionable to be gay, right? It was very controversial. The fact that Neil Rogers, the king of, you know, South Florida radio, actually comes out and as a gay man, yet he can't accept in somebody he knows that you're transgender.
Oh, there's some kind of weird innate prejudice against transgender with gay men. which has yet to be defined. I mean, the American Psychiatric Association, they're busy spending their time trying to define transgenderism. And you know, is it normal? Is it abnormal? And actually, they don't know what normal is. Oh, I think I see Maisoon.
You do?
Where? Yeah, but I turned the video off because you didn't warn me that on top of everything else, I'd be on camera.
Oh,
today.
No, you're not on camera. You're not on camera. Hey, how did you get there?
I don't know. This thing popped up on my Skype that said that you invited me to a video chat.
Oh, how funny. Well, you're here. Oh, yay. Maisoon, I want you to meet Boca Brittany. Boca, meet Maisoon Zayed. Am I saying your name correctly?
Yeah.
But Boca is the one who did this.
You know, I had this crazy aunt that lived in Jersey.
Nobody wants to hear that. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, now with the news from New Jersey, Maisoon Zayed.
And Maisoon, I'd like to extend a Laurel and Hardy apology for mispronouncing your name.
No, actually, you pronounce it right and Nicole mispronounces that.
Really?
Yeah. Well,
oh, I don't have to retract.
Maisoon?
It's not Maisoon, but he got Zayed right.
Zayed. I always say Zayed or something.
You say Zayed. Like,
Zayed.
Yeah.
Zayed.
Hi, guys. So hi. Boca, it's so nice to meet you, and thank you for my awesome, fabulous intro. I think Maisoon sounds cool, though, Nicole, because it goes with the Z.
Yes, I think so, too.
How are you?
I like it. So,
I'm delighted to meet you, too. I'm very, very thrilled, because I, if not for Keith Olbermann, I would not know.
I know. He needs to get back on TV so I can have more Bocas in my life.
Well, I do follow his show on Facebook.
Nice. His show on Facebook? He doesn't have a show on Facebook.
I know, but you know it from his postings. I don't know if that's posting it, but...
No, the Facebook's not his. Only the Twitter is.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, yeah. They do a fine job.
Yes, they do.
Fake. So, there are fake TV personalities all over the Twitter.
What are we talking about today?
Well, whatever you want. When we tried to reach you on Monday, I guess you were flying back from somewhere.
I was flying back from Hollywood, where I got to meet the greatest former Mr. Chachi Arcola, Scott Baio.
Now, how did you happen to be with Scott Baio?
Well, Scott Baio happens to have a brand new hit TV show called See Dad Run. And I run this thing called the New York Arab American Comedy Festival, yes, where we showcase up-and-coming Arab American talent who are, like, really, really good, not just Arab. And one of our kids got cast on his show in, like, a lead role. So I was out in Hollywood doing some work, and they invited me to the set to come watch a taping, and I got to meet Scott Baio, and it was epic. It was huge. I totally fall apart when I meet people. It's terrible because I'm supposed to be like their counterpart, their equal, and right? I just kind of crumple into like a mound of palsy. So he was absolutely lovely, and the taping was great, and it was at the old Happy Days studio on the Paramount lot.
Oh, that's cool.
I had a very Hollywood weekend. I hung out with many, like, name-droppy, very famous people. It was a wonderful, wonderful weekend.
Do tell. Who else?
I got to hang out with Tiger Williams, who is the writer of an awesome movie called Menace to Society.
Okay.
Which is a groundbreaking movie from the 90s that talks, like, a fiction about gangs in Compton. And it was the first time that, like, they were telling their story. It was a big deal.
You said very, very famous people. And, like, who? Okay.
Yeah, I know, but screenwriters, another writer, like, because I'm a writer, these are the famous people to me. Like, the people who wrote the groundbreaking movies to get, like, sit across from them is big for me.
Okay.
Since my name dropping doesn't impress you at all, I'll just repeat that I'm friends with Dave Matthews.
What? So you've got are you friends with Dave Matthews?
We did a movie together called You Don't Mess with the Zohan, but prior to us doing a movie together, I had gone and seen him 193 times with my very best friend, Michelle Pagella, because I love Dave Matthews. And then I got cast in this movie with Adam Sandler, and I was carrying a Dave Matthews backpack, and Adam was like, oh, you know, Dave Matthews is in this movie. I was like, yeah, right, whatever. And my whole life, I had always said, and this is to show you what positive thinking does, I always said, someday I'm going to meet Dave Matthews. We're going to become friends. I'm going to talk to him all about Palestine. And on the set of Zohan, I met Dave Matthews. We became friends. I talked to him all about Palestine. So it was awesome.
Well, you and know what? I mean, look, this is kismet here. Because do you know, I did the very first Los Angeles radio interview with Dave Matthews back in 1994.
Holy, wow. This
I'll send you the link to it because it's so funny to listen to because I'm talking to Dave Matthews and Stefan Lessard, I think, was with him. And, you know, talking about, yo, this is your first, we don't know you out here, but you're big on the East Coast. And, you know, you've got a couple of shows this weekend. You're going to be opening for Fish at the Santa Monica Civic. And you've got some shows at the Whiskey. Friday night is sold out, but there are still tickets available for Saturday night. The Whiskey holds like 200 people, if that. And so to tell Dave Matthews that, you know, on the radio, oh, the, you know, this new band, there's some tickets at the Whiskey to see Dave Matthews at the Whiskey. Can you imagine?
And that's exactly how it was with me. Like, I discovered him at the tail end of 93 and saw him in a club that seated like 150, which I believe was called the Rocking Horse, but I'm not sure. And it seated like 150. The very next year, I was at Garden State Arts Center, which seated like 25,000 people, you know, and it just kind of went like that. But so I wanted to talk to you about Christmas and charity.
Yes. Okay. And remember, Boca Brittany's still here. So, Boca, if you've got a question, if you want to jump in, just jump in.
You definitely will need to chime in on this, on the Christmas thing.
Okay.
So, first, I want to talk about charity, though. Okay. I'm having this controversy because there's always these things that cause controversy on my Twitter and Facebook that I don't find controversial, but everyone else seems to flip out about. And the controversy comes from this. Some people were buying toys on Amazon to send to kids in Palestine. And I just commented that this was a very bad idea because things that you send to Palestine tend to get confiscated by the Israelis and never make it in. And if it does make it in, it's taxed. So you're paying for toys that are being shipped and taxed, and it's kind of a waste of money. And it's better to either A, donate to something they really need, or B, buy toys locally and inject some money into an economy that sorely needs that kind of money. And so the people on my Facebook went Harry Carey, and the gist of it was, we feel good donating, why do you have to ruin it? And so I asked, doesn't it matter that your donation get where you want it to go? And the majority of people said no, they didn't care. That the point was they had donated and that they really didn't care whether it got there or not. Is this something that's common that I'm missing?
I don't think so. I mean, if you donate something, you want to know that it gets to the intended person, right?
He just accepted the fact that, like, say we donate to Komen or we donate to, you know, whatever organization, and we just accept the fact that, like, a huge chunk of it never gets there. Like, is it all symbolism? Because they were angry that I was ruining what they thought was a good donation. They're like, if my kid wants to buy a toy on Amazon and donate it, I'm not going to tell him not to. And I'm like, but don't you want your kid to do something that's actually going to get there, that's actually going to achieve something? Like, doesn't it matter? And like I said, the majority of the responses were no. And I think that a lot of us do throw money into the wind, not caring whether it gets to from point A to point B, which is why there's so much divisiveness in the charitable world.
Well, and not only in the charitable world. It's funny because I was listening to Randy Rhodes yesterday. I was in the car a lot yesterday, and she did a great job explaining, you know, we look at Americans for Prosperity, who's behind, you know, they were one of the forces driving this union-busting legislation in Michigan this week. And you look at, oh, for instance, FreedomWorks, where they just paid Dick Armey $8 million to leave. And she talked talked. She was saying, look, all this money that you people who think you're contributing to these think tanks and these super PACs to get your candidates elected, there, it's not going to get candidates elected. It's going to pay Dick Armey $8 million and go in the Koch brothers' pockets. And you're wondering, you know, why you're contributing all this money and it's not electing your candidates. That's why. It's not going where you think it's going.
It's going to $8 million to get rid of Dick Armey. Can someone please pay me a couple of million dollars to disappear?
Really?
I'll disappear for $500,000, actually.
No shit.
Just like, you know. But it was just so shocking to me because, like, you know, I have my little charity, Maysoon's Kids. And I'm the first person in the world to be like, no, I can't get that into Gaza. Like, I never take stuff that I can't handle, and I never touch money. It always goes like directly to the scholarship, directly to the playground, directly, you know what I mean? And I just felt like so disenchanted by the fact that people were like, don't ruin this. This is easy and fun. I get to go to Amazon, buy a toy. I feel really good. The fact that it doesn't get there and they actually have cleft palates and no shoes is not the point. And I'm just like, okay, huge disconnect. But that being said, most of your kids in the, not you, Nicole, but your listeners, most of the kids all you people have already have too much stuff.
Yes.
So, like, make this a teachable Christmas and make a donation and be like, this year I've donated to these people in your name and you're getting one less piece of crap because you have too much stuff. Like, all these kids have too much stuff. So, Boca, this brings me to my question. I'm Muslim. Nicole is godless.
Yes,
what
I am.
What do you do? I was raised with Christmas because I'm Palestinian. It's like a national holiday because Jesus was born in Palestine. But I feel really bad for like other Muslim kids who don't get to do the Christmas thing. Because as a child, there's a concept that like Santa hates you and you're just left out. So what do you do when you have kids that aren't Christian so that they don't get scarred for life by Christmas?
Well, you just go ahead and fake it.
You give them Christmas,
yes,
right?
I had Christmas as a kid. I gave Allison Christmas. Ooh, something didn't sound good there.
That wasn't me.
That wasn't you? What? Maysoon, you there?
I'm here.
Okay. There. Uh-oh. There was a weird noise there. Anyway, now I gave Allison Christmas when she was little until she busted me on Santa. When I first started seeing David, we had Christmas at our house. And then we came over here to his house. And we exchanged more gifts here, and I realized there were still some things in my car for Allison. And the thing is, Santa had one wrapping, and the gifts from me had another wrapping.
Oh,
and I
God.
Went into the car, and she was like 8 at this point. No, 9, I guess. And I brought stuff out from the car, and it's like, oh, I forgot these in the car. But one of them had the Santa wrapping. She's like, Mom, I thought that was Santa's wrapping. That's from you, isn't it? And so... you know, I Santa Claus is not a religious figure. Santa Claus is, you know, is everybody.
So
right?
It's become more like Thanksgiving, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. Well, see, I grew up Sicilian Jewish German Catholic.
Oh, wow. That is great.
And now you see the result.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So, no, talk to me about your holidays as a Sicilian Jewish German Catholic. Because I grew up as a Palestinian Muslim that hung out with Italian Catholics, and Italian Catholics know how to do Christmas.
Yeah, especially with the food. But we didn't leave any stone unturned. I mean, we had the menorah in the window, and we had the tree in the room.
You did both?
Everything.
Did you worry about the menorah setting the tree on fire?
No, it was electric.
Okay, that's a good call because that always worries me.
Well, you proved. So, yeah, we had about everything. We didn't miss a trick, and as it turns out, I'm about as godless as Nicole is now too. So, but it was fun. When you're a kid, you don't care. It's all about having a good time.
Yeah, Christmas isn't about God. Christmas is about. Here's what I think. I mean, for me, as a godless person, this time of year, I think it's more about, you know, the time of year. We made it through another fucking year, and the year is coming to an end, and we're celebrating the end and the new beginning. And it is for family. It's the time when you get together with friends and family. You have lots of parties. You eat too much, and you exchange gifts, and it's got nothing to do with God or Jesus.
Well, you know where I spend every Christmas though.
Where
is the Church of Nativity in Palestine, which is only funny because, again, I'm Muslim. And it's like really hard to score the tickets, but I always make sure that I do. And it's packed, packed, packed with tourists. And you go there at midnight and you see all the local political figures shaking hands and showing religious unity. And then, you know, Bishop comes in and whatnot, and he usually gets delayed at a checkpoint, and we all kvetch to the camera crews about how terrible this is. And I hang out in like the epicenter of it, you know what I mean? And those people are really, really religious. Like, yeah, they're super connected to the religious part. But then outside the church, it's the same thing. It's just a big party. And it doesn't matter, like, what religion you are. People are hanging out and selling toys and, like, doing the whole nine yards. It's like mini Rockefeller. But this was the worst year ever, so I don't even get to go for Christmas to culminate. Oh. No, because I had to do back-to-back trips this summer, so my miles are gone. Oh. So I have to wait. But I'm going to go in April. I'm going back in April to hang out and do shows and raise anarchy. You should come with me for the week. Do you want to come with us, Boca?
Sure, I think it would be a bomb.
It'd be, oh my God. To speak. Really? Really? Come on, sir. We got to elevate it, ma'am. I'm so confused right now. Catholic.
By the voice.
No, but Boca, we need you and Nicole, because I think that if I'm flanked by former Jews, they can't really stop me in the airport.
Well, okay.
It's like an invisible, it's like an invisible shield of protection.
Yeah, we just need a job first. We can't afford the tickets.
What? No, you can afford the tickets. Tickets are so much cheaper than you think.
Really?
You just have to time it between holidays. Yeah.
Really?
Stay away from Hanukkah, Easter, and Ramadan, and you're good to go. Yeah, you can get, first of all, you can get direct flight without stopping for 40,000 miles on United.
I don't have 40,000 miles.
Okay, then it's like $900. It's nothing. Do a Kickstart. People do Kickstarts for stupider things.
Do they?
Get on the computer and do a Kickstart and talk about finding your roots and, you know, how you
Kickstarter
strayed to atheism and you're trying to get back to
Kickstarter was only for creative ventures, like to do a movie.
Yeah, and Boca are going to do radio from there and talk about refinding your religious roots.
I see.
And whatnot.
I'm going to do davening at the. Oh, by the way.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm very upset to hear about the charity thing, because I don't know what to do with this Nerf ball assault rifle that I had here. Sorry.
Okay. So only not funny because yesterday a teen in Palestine got shot to death after his birthday because he had a fake gun, like a toy gun. And he got shot by an Israeli soldier. And this is another fight that I'm always having with people, because I'm always saying we can't buy toy guns for these kids. It's too dangerous.
I agree.
And they say I'm crazy.
No, but I agree with – look, even when she was little – if Allison wanted like any kind of water gun, had to be like in the shape of a fish or something. I didn't allow toy guns. No guns. Sorry.
I buy the refugee Nerf guns, though, because I think it's about time that he released that frustration in a nonviolent fashion.
Ew.
So,
Boca, her husband's the chef-ugee.
Yeah, my chef-ugee, a refugee who makes falafel.
Falafel.
How do you like that, Boca? My husband fits every Arab stereotype. So what was your best Christmas gift ever, Nicole?
God, I don't know. You know, here's the thing. We used to get Christmas gifts. When I was little, we lived in an apartment in New York. And we never had a Christmas tree. We had a little toy wind-up Christmas tree that played Silent Night, go figure. But we'd have our presents all on Christmas morning, and my parents never wrapped anything either because they were lazy. So they'd out all around just the living room, just all over the place. And we'd get them. But when I was about 9, maybe 8, we started then coming to Florida every year for Christmas vacation, and that was the end of our Christmas presents, because the trip to Florida was the... And then when I was 11, we moved down here. So that was sort of it.
Okay, do you have a best gift?
My favorite of all time was back when I was young. I wanted a 007 attaché case.
Nice.
I don't want to date myself or anything, but my mother went out and bought a 006 case because it was on sale. And he opened it up and it was filled with King Korn stamps. Oh, anyway. I'm dating myself.
You really are dating yourself.
Okay. Need to,
wow.
That's awesome. Mine is a tie between, I got a fake fur coat that I just totally loved and like wore every single day until it got like really ratchety and like nasty and clumpy.
Yeah.
And then Simon. It's this
Simon,
game
the game
like
with the lights,
oh
the four
God.
Lights, the circle. I remember
yes,
Simon.
Yes, I love Simon.
That was like one of the first electronic games. I remember yeah. Simon. I had that too. Hey,
it
Maysoon.
It was palsy perfect because you smack it. Yes, aww. Go ahead, Mom.
Before we go, I played this before you came on when I couldn't get you. It's a Boca comedy bit that I want you to hear.
How did you not get me? I've been here the whole time.
I don't know. Okay, here we go.
Sitting here, la la, waiting for my ya-ya.
When you want to get your ya-yas looking at some yabas, go to the Gaza. Strip joint, that is. Hello, I'm Joey Gaza, owner and proprietor of the Gaza Strip Joint. Inviting you to come on down to the Gaza Strip, where we feature a wide range of talented girls that can perform amazing acts with a dollar bill or in one of our plushly appointed back rooms. This week's headliner at the Gaza is Zsa Zsa. You're going to love this one, guys. She squirts grenades out of her thing. So get your ya-yas at the Gaza.
Gaza Strip Joint, located just 1 mile east of the industrial complex across from the abandoned Sinclair Station.
What can I say, Boca? You have a way with you have a way with making massacres more uncomfortable. that is all I can say to you, my friend. All is fair in comedy, and that was
all that is was, fair in comedy, and that
all
that,
is
yeah,
fair
there
in
you
comedy.
Go.
Okay. There's grenades involved in that yeah. song. And
yeah.
Anyway, I love you all, my heathen friends. May you find God before Christmas Day so Santa doesn't forget
yeah,
you.
That ain't going to happen. And it doesn't, we don't need Santa to
I'm off until the inauguration.
Okay.
I have a show on, my show was supposed to be, it's like a peace ball for the inauguration.
Yeah.
But they got the date wrong and we're on the 20th and the inauguration's on the 21st. So.
That's okay. You're the pre-inauguration festivities.
Yeah, man.
All right.
I'm very excited. Goodbye, sweetie. I'll
bye, honey. I'll talk to you later. And Boca Brittany, find her at thatbocashow.com. And thank you. I'll talk to you guys. Talk to you guys later. Bye. All right, we're out of time. And I was gonna finish up with Bruce Springsteen doing "Born to Run," but the damn video has a commercial. Go figure. All right. So on that note, have a great weekend, everyone.